My teacher, Dr. Swaran Arora, was very visionary, I would say, to give me this topic of liposuction for my thesis in 1993. Since then, the operation has got a lot of changes. Many new things have come, and the scope of liposuction has expanded so much that all cosmetic as well as reconstructive surgeons should know this as a basic technique. Also, the social fabric and demand to look healthy and fit, and so everyone wants to lose weight or inches. So why did liposuction revolutionize body contouring surgery? The traditional body contouring surgeries in olden times, they were excisional. There were long scars, wound healing problems. There was likelihood of necrosis. And after going through such an ordeal, there were abruptly changing and ugly contours. The results were not very natural looking. So life was turned out to be that bastion where the subcutaneous tissues could be collapsed. Liposuction achieved discontinuous undermining without damaging the blood supply, thereby reducing the chances of necrosis. It improved the mobility of the tissues and skin. It reduced the tension on the closure, and thus it gave very pleasing and smooth contours which looked very natural, and that is what all the patients of cosmetic surgery desire. They want to mix in the society. They don't have the scars or irregularity. Applications of liposuction can be considered as threefold. It can be a standalone body contour procedure, or it can be ancillary procedure to improve results of other excisional procedures like abdominoplasty, gynecomastia, etc. And now emerging trend is liporeduction. Large volume liposuction has found its way in the book also. And if you take proper precautions, then you can have a safe surgery and provide a life-changing experience to your patient. The tools of liposuction can be considered as five. Infiltration. These are essential components of all liposuction procedures. You require infiltration, you require cannula to separate the fat and bring it out. You require a non-collapsible tubing through which the fat will reach the collection device with a suction mechanism incorporated in between. Infiltration is a very important component of liposuction procedure. It consists usually of Ringer's lactate or normal saline. And provides volume to the infiltration. In large volume liposuction, Ringer is used because it is more physiological. It provides quintessential tumescence or swelling to the tissues so that they can be sucked without too much of trauma. If you suck lax tissues, then they will be torn from their blood supply. It also achieves hydrotomy. Adrenaline is used for hemostasis, but when you are doing liposuction under local anesthesia, it delays the lignocaine absorption. Lignocaine is mainly for anesthesia. To balance the acidity caused by lignocaine, soda bicarb is used. Another important ingredient which I use in my practice is hyaluronidase. It achieves fibrolysis and cell membrane breakdown. Some people use hydrocortisone. I don't use it, and it is not supposed to be a quintessential component. These are the general compositions when you are doing larger volume liposuction. You can have less of lignocaine and epinephrine, but if it is small, then you can put higher doses. To all the students, whoever wants, you can take screenshots of my slide. I have made the slides for you so that you can make a quick revision at the time of examination. So you are free to take screenshots. The types of infiltration can be dry when you don't infiltrate anything, but the blood loss is 25-30%. Wet liposuction is when you infiltrate one aspirate 1 cc. In super wet technique, you infiltrate 1.5. This is the technique which dropped the blood loss to 4%. Even in wet liposuction, the blood loss is 10%, but when you add epinephrine, it becomes less than 5%. And Tumison technique, you input 3 and take out only 1 cc. In this, the blood loss is said to be negligible. Now, it is very interesting to check out how the infiltration evolved and why the Tumison technique came to be and whether it is very relevant to the plastic surgeons or not. It was Fournier and Illouz who were the Parisian plastic surgeons who were doing liposuction almost simultaneously. Fournier used the dry technique, but later he conceded to the advantages of the Illouz mixed a distilled water in normal saline and hyaluronidase and called it a wet technique. And he said that the advantages of wet technique are fat becomes fluffier, there is hydrodissection, which reduces the surgeon's effort, there is reduced bleeding. Now, at that time, the anesthesia gases were such that the epinephrine addition would cause cardiac arrhythmia because of sensitization of the myocardium. But later, Hetter showed that in epinephrine does not cause arrhythmias, and also the nature of gases changed. From halothane, it became isoflurane, and now there are better fluorines like sevoflurane. So the incidence of cardiac arrhythmia became almost negligible. Now, Tumison liposuction is thought to be the very modern way of doing liposuction. How it came to be, Dr. Jeffrey Klein is a dermatosurgeon in California. He saw some liposuctions done by surgeons in their operation theaters. And he decided that liposuction should be possible under local anesthesia, which was a wonderful idea. So in order to do liposuction on office procedure basis, he increased the dilution of the local anesthesia, achieving a larger volume to spread over wider areas and to get larger areas of anesthesia. He really did very elaborate experiments in which he showed that peak concentration of lidocaine is achieved after 12 hours and not after. If it happened in 2 hours, there would be a lot of lidocaine toxicity. He also proved that safe dosage of lignocaine was 35 milligram per kg. Below you can find some links to the papers he has published in PRS, and also he proved that Tumison technique can be used for large volume liposuction as well. Now, when this was taken by plastic surgeons, there were many cases of fluid overload. Actually, tumes means only to swell up, and the plastic surgeons at that time did raise objections. They noted fluid overload, and it took 1992 for Hanstad to prove that the balance between infiltration IV fluids and fluid shifts induced by liposuction have to be managed meticulously to avoid fluid overload and pulmonary edema. Another objection was too much fluid alters the shape, so you don't know what kind of shape you are finally going to land with. Anesthesia you give, the plastic surgeons found that there was always some pain, discomfort. This was of course not a documented thing, but this is mentioned in PRS in Dr. Aaron Stone's comment that patients who came after having had this Tumison liposuction experience complained that they continued to have a lot of pain and discomfort. For plastic surgeons, we must understand that liposuction is a major procedure involving fluid shifts, so anesthesiologist is a good asset for us to monitor the patient. Howsoever small amount And lastly, to quote Dr. Stone in PRS March 1995, he said that cutting corners by touting liposuction as an office procedure compromises sterility safety of the operation. So what we have to understand is tumescent liposuction is a different concept than tumescent technique of liposuction. In tumescent liposuction, it is accomplished totally under local anesthesia, and this is quoted in Dr. Klein's paper clearly that if you are giving tumescent liposuction. Another important contribution of Dr. Klein was introduction of microcanaliculi. So it became an advantage because it had to be done under local. He used smaller cannulas and they found that the contours could be better. So how to avoid fluid overload when you are using tumescent technique, which causes negligible blood loss? You have to minimize IV fluids during early part of the surgery. You have to limit total amount of IV fluids, strict input-output monitoring, infiltrate one part at a time. This is my personal experience when I was discussing large volume liposuction with one of my colleagues. I realized that he was putting of fluid. If he was expecting to remove 10 liters, he would infiltrate around 10 liters of fluids, and then there would be epinephrine toxicity leading to bradycardia. So please remember that you have to plan your large volume liposuction in such a way you divide it area wise, infiltrate one area. When you are about to finish that area in 10 minutes later, then you start infiltrating the other part. Another important understanding is postoperatively, when you give compression garment, there is a fluid shift from the extracellular space to the intravascular compartment. So even in postoperative period, immediate fluid requirement is not there. So what is the formula for fluid replacement? It is Roerich's formula. Replace 0.25 ml of crystalloids per cc of aspirate above 5 liters of liposuction. This is what will make your large volume liposuction safe. These are the various devices. Hinge was by me for almost 7-8 years. My hands used to go red, and liposuction was so tiring experience that time. But then I started using this pressure bag, which is used in laparoscopic surgeries, and inside you can see catheter is attached and the fluid is infused into the tissues. When you raise the pressure, it goes in very fast. So for beginners who don't want concentration pump, this is a wonderful option. This also I used for many years. This is the infiltration pump. This is digital. You can control the flow. And beauty of the pump is that you can reverse the pump for fat grafting. Nowadays, we are doing lot of fat grafting along with liposuction to correct irregularities. Non-collapsible silicone tubing is essential. It has to be thick walled and autoclavable, and the tube has to be regularly changed because of autoclaving. It becomes soft, and a soft tube, it will start collapsing. The collection jar has to be hard grafting. Otherwise, you should be able to replace it quickly. So have enough number of jars. This is the photo of the tubing. You can see how thick the wall is. Suction machine is high powered with dual cylinder piston pump. Usually they have cooling fans, and you should be able to achieve -736 millimeter of mercury pressure within 10 to 15 seconds. And now non-oil emulsion machines reduce the operation theater contamination. Syringe was used as a suction device, and its use was pioneered by Dr. Luis Toledo from Brazil. And he said that the freedom of movement is wider, because when you hold the liposuction cannula, long cannulas, the power assisted handpiece, there is a certain distance you have to be away from the patient, whereas when you hold a syringe you can go very near and correct the anomalies, irregularities more easily, or the deformities. Then he also created patient's body map by keeping records of amount of local anesthetics put in and the fat taken out to achieve symmetry. And this I follow in my practice. Even if I use infiltration pump, I do keep these records and remove equal amounts from either side so as to achieve maximum possible symmetry. And 60 cc syringe can definitely provide -1 atmospheric pressure. The cannula, these are the details of the cannula attributes, I would say. I will not go into the detail, but these are the cannula numbers that are commonly used, 3, 4, 5 for body, 1 and 2 for face and neck, and 0.9 or 0.8 for microliposuction of jowls, nasolabial folds, etc. Sharp cannulas are used for subdermal liposuction to induce skin contraction, and also useful in fibrous areas like back or gynecomastia. Pickle fork cannula is used for management of cellulite. So these are the cannulas, and these are the thicker cannulas. This is 10 number cannula, and I now shudder to think that I once used it so heavily, but the times have changed now. Now these are much better. These are various examples of power assisted cannulas. A Mercedes cannula is where the holes are distributed at 60 degree angle. There are three holes. This is a double Mercedes. Flared cannula again is useful in the fibrous areas where there is tough fat, and also very useful for fat grafting. This is a spiral sharp cannula to induce the dermal contraction, and this is for face. Flat cannula to avoid any injury. Now, if you consider lipolysis, it can be chemical, mechanical, or heat-based. Chemical lipolysis is done using phosphatidylcholine and artichoke injections. They are given about 0.5 millimeters below the skin surface, and it will destroy the fat over a zone of 3 to 4 millimeters. It is extremely useful in eliminating smaller irregularities that remain after liposuction, and every plastic surgeon should know the use of it for especially fussy patients. Mechanical liposuction and heat-based liposuction, I try to discuss as briefly as possible. Once again, you are please free to take screenshots. Plasma and water jet are the new advances. Including them, plasma is used mainly for skin tightening and after the liposuction, and water jet is mainly focused on fat harvest. So an ideal device should remove excessive fat without compromising viability of the skin envelope. It should facilitate contraction of the soft tissue envelope around the bony contours. It should be safe without many complications and should allow procedure under minimal anesthesia with minimal bruising and swelling. In ultrasound-assisted liposuction, Dr. Zocchi was the innovator of this concept. Now we are in the third generation stage of use of ultrasound, and this is the full form vibration amplification of sound energy in resonance. This is the third generation. Weser machine uses solid titanium probes with grooves at the tip to enhance energy transfer. There are three types of effects. One is micromechanical effect, that is minimal. Thermal effect due to friction of ultrasound waves, that is also not very significant. The most significant is microcavity expectation. The ultrasound energy reaches the extracellular gaps. There is expansion of these gaps followed by passive contraction, and this cycle continues to cause implosion of the adipocytes because of the membrane rupture, and the intracellular lipids are delivered in the extracellular space. So Weser selects the fat cells to damage. Now Weser mode is a pulse mode, and it allows equal efficiency at lower power, and this is what has made Weser very safe now. It is very useful for softer tissues and scarring. You need to use a power assisted or a traditional liposuction to remove the residual fat that is broken. The precautions that must be followed when doing a Weser liposuction are thorough infiltration beyond the target area, because your ultrasound waves are going to travel beyond where you want them to stop. So you have to be very careful to keep infiltration there so that the further area is not damaged. The skin at the entry point must be protected. Cross tunneling is desirable. Technical precaution is avoid hitting the dermis from inside. These are called end hits, and smaller probes with more grooves and continuous mode are useful for area with fibrous septa for faster fragmentation, and bigger probes are useful for rapid debulking of the tissue. So step one is emulsification of the fat using Weser. Step two is PAL or suction assisted lipoaspiration. And the lipoaspirate contains 80% fat. So it is very, very effective. 90% of cellular disruption, and the fat harvested can be used for fat transfer, autologous fat transfer, because the cells are found to be viable. The common complications of Weser are seroma. Seroma is commoner because it requires extra infiltration. There is possible lymphatic damage because of the heat. Induration and prolonged swelling are also common. This is ultrasound assisted liposuction burn, which I have seen about 10 years back when it was very new. The newer devices are very good and safe. And this is an example of excellent contouring Weser can achieve. This is done at my place. I have done power assisted liposuction with buttock fat grafting. And Dr. Guleria has done the this ultrasound Weser before I did the liposuction. You can even see these venous dimples created so nicely, and the bar of the tissue in the gluteal cleft is dissolved. Coming to lasers, it was also proposed by Apfelberg, and there have been many innovators. It was aimed at mitigating the mechanical trauma that was being caused during liposuction. So let me take this opportunity to emphasize that liposuction is a traumatic procedure. It causes adipose tissue injuries, nerves which are there in the septa and the connective tissue, which sets an inflammatory response like internal burns. There is third space loss of RBCs and albumin. It triggers inflammatory cascade, and the systemic response is evoked, and it is independent of the amount of fat removed. So again, one more screenshot you can take. These are the lasers, and these are the various wavelengths and their targets used in laser liposuction. How laser acts is by heat absorption. Some of the laser waves, they are absorbed, some are scattered, and the scatter helps by increasing the area of involvement. At low energy, they alter the sodium potassium balance of the cells into the cell, which finally breaks down. And at high energy, they directly disrupt the adipocytes, leading to fat loss. They cause vascular coagulation, so bleeding is minimum. Collagen injury leads to remodeling of the collagen. So these are the advantages as well as disadvantages. Whenever there is any advantage, there is a potential disadvantage that you should remember. It is said that after laser liposuction for small amounts, the fat is actually dead. The cells are dead. They are not viable and they cannot be used for fat transfer. So if you do laser for small areas, then there is no need to aspirate. But if you do that in larger areas, there will be fat necrosis and scarring. As I said, because of vascular coagulation, blood loss, bruising is less. So it is highly recommended for large volume liposuction and post-bariatric liposuction. The heat effects of laser, they allow tightening of the skin. You can use a smaller cannula size, useful in fibrous and precision areas and cellulite management. This was proposed by Dr. Goldman and he showed wonderful improvement using ND. Q-switched NDAG laser for cellulite improvement way back when it was introduced. Then surgeon's effort is reduced due to liquefaction of the fat and you can easily deduce the disadvantages. Hyperfibrosis is very important possible side effect and it may require triamcinolone injection. There one case of rhabdomyolysis has been reported. So this was the laser workshop held at my place where Dr. Alexander Levenberg had come. Next new kid on the block is radio frequency assisted liposuction. The concept is the same, but it has internal sensors and instead of fat, it targets the fibroceptal network. It also with heat allows dermal and skin tightening, causes liquefaction of the fat. This also is claimed to reduce the blood loss. And the beauty is that after power assisted or other liposuctions, there is some laxity which sets in after 3 months. Whereas in radio frequency assisted liposuction, this laxity actually doesn't occur and there is improvement, progressive improvement in the country. This was a recent new addition in my repertoire. The advantages I think sometimes in the learning phase, this adds treatment time.
Excuse me, I think Dr. Parimal Kulkarni, I think your mic is on. Please switch off your mic, please. Shravan, can you do something?
I'm muted.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I think you'll have to share.
Okay. Can you hear me now? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So there is also a prolonged edema due to lymphatic damage. And I have to patiently wait for 3 months to see the results. And the innovator prefers actually drain for the abdominal liposuction. In the 5 or 6 cases I have done so far, I have never used drain, but let us see. It is never, never in plastic surgery. One minute, there is a little bit of glitch at my end. Yeah. So this is the radio frequency and you can hear the noise. That noise indicates that the internal temperature cutoff has been achieved, so you should stop the liposuction. So among the heat-based devices, I thought this is a quite safe one. And I have done very few patients. It is a newly introduced machine. The first one was sold in India around September only. So I think IAPS had a nice webinar on this. So this is only a 3 weeks result. There is no scar and you can see excellent retraction. So the flip side of all the heat-based devices is that additional treatment time to distribute the heat, you require a modality anyway to remove the liquefied fat, there is a prolonged edema and possible complications of overheating. Another screenshot for the students, this is a comparison of tools. It is based on an article in 2014. The radio frequency device is not included here. I think there will be some revisions soon now. So you can see that microarray or power assisted is the fastest. Laser and water jet give excellent viable fat for transfer. Laser gives very good skin contraction. So everything has advantages as well as disadvantages. Now I am going to tackle complications in liposuction first, because when students get into practice and embark on this procedure, that this is a very simple, easy procedure by some other specialties, and they should actually know exactly what is the extent of the procedure and what complications can take place, so that they can provide a safe result to the patient. It is very important to keep these patients safe. Because one death and the whole practice in your territory will, reduce. And one such death nowadays travels so widely because of the social media, that this beautiful procedure can develop misunderstanding among the patients. The factors that increase risk of liposuction were compiled by American Association of Plastic Surgeons Task Force. So these are authentic. So in too much and too many can cause complications. If you do it for wrong indication, there can be complications. And inadequate monitoring of a patient is another very important cause for problems. These are the specific complications of liposuction. Our IAPS has got a proper consent made for your use. If you become IAPS members, you can have access to these consents, which are approved by a panel. There are life-threatening complications and aesthetic complications, and we have to leave no stone unturned to prevent at least the life-threatening complications, because aesthetic complications are commoner and some of them may occur. We should give that much of leeway to the surgeon. Hypotension, pulmonary embolism can occur. Hypotension is seen in most of the patients around midnight, so I prefer to admit each and every patient. Even a giddy patient that visits the washroom can fall. Hemorrhage has been reported in a podium presentation. The patient had factor VIII deficiency. Perforation has also been reported in the podium presentation. There can be necrotizing infection because of improper instruments, improper sterilization. Aesthetic complications are quite common, hematoma and bruising. You have to sensitize the patient to these. Seroma can occur. I'm not going to deal much with seroma in my lecture, because it is in itself is a big topic. What I would like to point out is non-tubercular mycobacterial infection. Many of the freelancing plastic surgeons, they use Cydex to sterilize the cannulas. Many times in the same endoscopes may be there, and then there can be contamination of your instruments, resulting in localized non-tubercular mycobacterial infection, and it is a huge ordeal to diagnose, treat, and it will always leave some ugly scar. So we should not use instruments from Cydex. Autoclave all your instruments. Skin necrosis can sometimes happen because of overzealous use of heat-based devices or overzealous subdermal liposuction. Dysesthesias, dyschromias, irregularities, and under and over corrections are well known, and use of autologous fat transfer can really help you to take care of the irregularities. I will discuss only one important complication in detail, that is pulmonary embolism. It can occur because of either thrombus or fat. When there is, the presentation is clinically different, when it is because of a thrombus, there is a sudden onset chest pain, a painful breathing, breathlessness, shock and hypoxia, and it can be diagnosed by CT angiography. It presents with drowsiness, confusion, delirium, seizures, petechial rash, that is diagnostic, and lipiduria. Lipiduria is difficult to diagnose and rare. So all I would like to say is that you have to be very friendly with one physician. You have to discuss the pathophysiology of liposuction as a surgery with the physician. There are many advances happening in medicine, and they have experience in managing thromboembolism as well as fat embolism from other sectors of operations or medical conditions. So rather than getting into detail of treating these conditions, we should be in touch with a physician. I would prefer that in every case of liposuction, a physician is involved from the stage of fitness, so that if there is any problem, you can take expert help and provide best care possible to the patient, so that the safety is not compromised. Pulmonary embolism, I would just give a list of risk factors that are because of liposuction. There are other risk factors because of surgery and anesthesia. They are general. So these are the various liposuction related risk factors. The notable ones are multiple concomitant procedures and circumferential thigh liposuction and excessive liposuction involving more than 30% of total body surface area. So we can definitely work on these factors and try to reduce the patient's risk. Thromboprophylaxis is a must in every case of liposuction, where you have to properly hydrate. DVT pump is an essential investment. It is not very costly and worth every penny you spend on it. Crepe bandages can be tied to the calves as a substitute, but not a good one, obviously. You have to mobilize the patient early after operation. Chemoprophylaxis can be considered, but we are definitely worried about subcutaneous bleeding because of enoxaparin. So I wonder if anyone uses enoxaparin in every case of liposuction. Now there are oral anticoagulants available, but there are no studies which suggest their use in liposuction. Now coming to the concepts in large volume liposuction, weight is measured on a weighing scale and size is measured in inches as skin fold thickness and circumference. But few patients come for localized fat deposits in practice. What they come for is weight loss. Another important concept in liposuction commonly used by non-plastic surgeons is body mass index. Weight in kilograms upon height in meter square, these are the numbers. So we will see how these apply to liposuction in various ways. These are the ideal patients. You know, this is a BMI of 23 and she came actually for natural augmentation of the breast. So liposuction was done, but in such small deposits, you can give a very good contour. But most of the patients that come to us, they come for weight loss because they are much larger patients. Now, when you say that somebody has put on weight, do you weigh the patient, that person? You don't. You are looking at the size of that person and guesstimating the weight. So actually, when the patient is asking us for what weight loss, what he is seeking is loss of inches. The patient wants to look slim and patient wants to be healthy. So you have to set the patient's concepts correct and direct them to fat loss, inch loss, improved posture, less backache and less shoulder pain after treatment of the areas that with which the patient is concerned. You should also have working knowledge of diet and exercise. Any patient who doesn't want to follow correct lifestyle should not be chosen for liposuction. I don't like diet charts because patients don't follow them. I teach them how to choose from whatever food is available. I teach them about calorie control, protein and carbs proportion. So that is, I think, a better method rather than shoving diet charts on them. Then you should also have idea about non-surgical methods of weight loss. Oral medicines are useful in post-operative period. Various devices that are rampant in the market like heating pads and EMS machines, you should be aware about. Cavitation and injection lipolysis do work to a limited extent, and you can use them as an aid in your clinic to give a post-operative care to the patient to improve the fat loss further after liposuction. Surgical methods, when the BMI is more than 35, usually patients should be referred to bariatric surgery, whereas the patients for liporeduction are between 26 to 35 BMI. Now, is BMI really the correct parameter? Because fat weighs less, it is lighter, so fat will give you volume and an appearance of weight gain, whereas actual weight is contributed by the muscle and bone. Now, this lady is actually far more healthier and fitter than I am, but her BMI is much more. So BMI, you should have these realities at the back of your mind and try to find a sustainable, safe and sensible solution to the patient's problem. We are definitely not seeking to treat patients who frequent McDonald's, but we must remember that patients can come from McDonald's to you at some whim and fancy when they don't want to follow diet and exercise, with misunderstanding that it is a substitute, or our operated patients can visit McDonald's. So a comprehensive care program for sustainable results with proper counseling is a must. So goals of the comprehensive care are diagnosis and post-operative care. Approach to a LVL patient should involve a team where you should have ICU backup and a physician backup along with diet, exercise and psychological counseling. To explain the patients, I use these three terms. There are many fancy names invented by they are giving better shape and doing a better operation. But liposuction is aspiration of adipose tissue. Lipoplasty is aspirate and shape the muscle and the skin underlying. And liposculpture is improve contour through aspiration and injection of fat obtained from the same person. You must know the anatomy of the fat tissue. Under the skin, the fat is packed into two layers, with superficial fascia in between. The septa contain fat vessels and nerves. The tunnels are created in both the levels, and there is a collapse of the subcutaneous tissue. Suction are deeper to the superficial fascia. This is a labile layer. It has to be removed thoroughly for long-lasting results, because this is where the overeaten accumulated fat is deposited. Superficial layer is usually fixed and it has to be still removed to some extent to facilitate draping around bony prominences. If you remove too much of superficial layer, there will be irregularities. Subdermal liposuction are done to tighten the skin and so, what is the difference between liposuction and liporeduction? The difference is in the goal and the patient that you select. In liporeduction, the goal is inch loss and good contour as much as possible to achieve a slimmer appearance. And the patient chosen should be less than 110 kg usually. There are no references for this, but this is what I follow in my practice. Goals intensive care in liposuction patients, as far as diagnosis is concerned, you have to consider thyroid, diabetes and the medicines, because medicines like pioglitazone cause weight gain. So if a diabetic patient, you are planning to do liposuction on his own pioglitazone, you have to stop it. This is a patient seemingly ideal, and she came for a second sitting in 2006. After that, she developed thyroid and gained, and medical treatment, she lost everything that she had gained, and this is a 10-year follow-up. So this is the importance of comprehensive care, that patient should be able to come back to you for weight gain and still should get help to lose that fat. So this is a lateral view. She is very well maintained. PCOD is important to know about, and these are the Rotterdam criteria for diagnosis. Patients is for plastic surgeon. They have acne, hirsutism, male pattern hair loss, all of which we can treat simultaneously, and you can build a good trust. Almost 8.5% of all women are affected now. We see PCOS cases very often. They have a cardiovascular risk. Most important is 5 to 10% of weight loss is very, very beneficial, and that is the safety limit of our liposuction. So we can definitely offer this as a solution. So what is different about polycystic ovaries, that abdominal skin is not stretched as in pregnancy. So these are young unmarried girls usually, so good skin because they are unmarried, the scars are not acceptable, and lifestyle changes and motivation, they are likely to comply much better because they have their life, the rest of the life ahead, and they want to really get slim and fit. Some examples, this was an architect by profession. I am just now showing my patients, and most of these patients have been followed up at 1 year, and I have complained of weight loss and inch loss. So these are various patients. Unfortunately, this patient could not maintain her loss after 2 years. She gained a lot of weight and had to go for bariatric surgery. So occasional non-compliant patients are there, or they have some hormonal changes which necessitate other measures. This is another patient. This is a result after 2 years, and after 11 years, this is how she was. You can see in the lateral view that after this 2 years, she lost touch with me also and did not follow proper diet, but still her upper abdomen is quite well maintained, whereas she has gained lot of fat on the thigh, including cellulite. Another patient, there is definitely a bit of laxity and irregularity at the end of 2 years, and we are hoping that this radio frequency machine will improve our late results as well. So you can see the amount of loss. This is another 10 years now. She came to me for umbilical hernia, and I have recently done her abdominoplasty. You can do staged procedures if you are worried about the safety, and because there are chances of hemoglobin dropping after a very large volume liposuction, so I usually don't go above 10 to 12 liters now. The plan has to be discussed with the patient, and planning can be done. Some surgeons like to do a region-wise planning, like they will complete the abdomen and back in one sitting and go for thighs at a later date. Or how I prefer is I like to balance the overall contour so that doesn't come for the next liposuction, and many of them don't want to do it because of the pain. They will have a result and presentable contour. So this is an example of that. She had weight loss of 11 kg. In the next sitting, she had gained a little bit of weight, and that is fat actually. And then she had another procedure. These are all young girls who cannot wear clothes. They cannot mix with their peers. You can see the good amount of inch loss. So these are all the polycystic ovaries patients. They also require some amount of medical treatment, oral drugs with the help of a gynecologist. This is little older patient, but still good amount of inch loss and well maintained. So if the patient has got a reasonable expectation, even older age group can have large volume liposuction. Many patients are worried about abdominoplasty and they have poor skin, poor muscle tone and high BMI, but still they want some improvement, and you can definitely offer them liposuction and they are quite happy with the result when the protruding abdomen is reduced. So these are the compilations.